So yeah, Jody, so what's your take on supplementation?
As far as us talking about, like, if it's necessary or not, I think it is. I don't think, especially if you're training when it comes to, like, sports or especially bodybuilding, I don't think it's really possible to get all the nutrients you're going to need without having to supplement. And with that being said, too, it's like if you're training really hard, like we were talking about last week, was like your nervous system can take a beating. So that makes, you know, your omegas essential. That makes, a B complex essential just for your nervous system alone, mm-hmm. And then
adaptogens like ashwagandha is really good for that. Yeah.
That's good for
EGCG, epilation through galate.
Mental clarity and stuff, too. But, you know, I do think, you know, then it comes into play a lot of other things, like we talked about the fiber. But then there's other things, too, that I always find really important for my clients, especially is that, kind of like some of the main things I think about when it comes to like developing like a little supplement plan for my clients. Mm-hmm. Usually, well, first one is just kind of like overall like chemical reactions inside the body require vitamins and minerals. Mm-hmm. So just to have all the chemical reactions inside your body, just, you know, to make your heart beat, to, you know, help you breathe, to push blood, you know, through and allow for the valves to close back up so blood doesn't, you know, back up. There's all kinds of things inside the body that just need those things just to do very simple things that we all take for granted. So that's usually kind of like number one.
Electrolytes.
Two would usually be performance. So I'm looking at, like, especially when it's coming to bodybuilding or sports-oriented stuff, I'm looking at, like, muscle contraction and just, like, overall ability to, like, produce more power. Mm-hmm. So then for that, I usually look at vitamin D, calcium. I think those are, like, two of the main ones. Mm-hmm. I use, like, a calcium citrate mixed with the vitamin D. And then a small amount of the vitamin K as well. Mm-hmm. And actually, because calcium is one of the main like neurotransmitters for muscle contraction. Mm-hmm. And so I make sure that's usually a very essential thing, especially because typically getting ready for any kind of competition, whether it's sports or bodybuilding, we're usually cutting out a lot of dairy, which is one of the more bioavailable forms of calcium. Mm-hmm. So getting it into your supplementation is going to be way more effective.
Good point. Yeah.
And then the last thing, and not necessarily in the level of importance, but the last thing is usually digestive. So that's where I'll typically throw in digestive and hormonal stuff too. So whether you're supplementing with like exogenous hormones or not, I do think any type of regulation of whatever your body can be possibly producing at the moment is essential for you to take control of as best you can through your supplementation as well. So vitamin D is another one that's going to be good for that. Yeah. I usually incorporate like just your omega-3s. So I usually say like a fish oil because it's usually a little bit more bioavailable. And then go into an omega-6. I usually tell somebody to grab like either borage oil or even primrose oil. Mm-hmm. And then we're just looking at, I usually just go get like psyllium husk fiber. Mm-hmm. And that just seems to kind of do the trick. I do like the species, the Fiberlize. I like that a lot. But I use that for my clients, not necessarily as a supplement, but as like a sort of like calorie-free, like craving reducer. Especially when like, you know, they finish their last meal or whatever, uh-huh, at like 9 o'clock at night, and then they're laying there in bed hungry.
Because it takes up space in the supplement.
It's like a brick. And expands. Like he was saying.
Especially like the fiber glucanamin.
Coagulates, he was saying. It's like the stuff expands. Like if you pour a little bit into a cup of water, and like if you pour, you know, this, like a small amount of it at the bottom of the cup and you fill that cup all the way to the top, that cup will be completely full of fiberlize. Yeah. You know, like, and it'll just be like,
and what is that supplement? Isn't it Lipodrin that actually had, it's just a fiber supplement basically. And it was all over the TV and it was about for losing fat.
I don't know.
Do you remember that?
No.
I mean, fiber is another thing though too, where that comes into like just your normal everyday.
There was one.
High fiber. And you look at the ingredients, just fiber.
That's just fiber.
It was just that one fiber, like that glucanamine thing.
It's like taking Metamucil.
And only because it expands like 600 times its size.
Right.
You know?
Right. And they made you full.
Yeah, and it made you full. Yeah. And it was like the miracle fat loss. And like, I'm sorry if I'm getting it wrong, but it was like Lipodrin or something. You could find it at Long's and at Walmart. But there was infomercial after infomercial, and you're like, whoa, what is this? What is this great new fat burner? You look at the ingredients, fiber.
You know, since we're on supplementation and talking about necessary or not, I've got a prime example. I don't know why it did not dawn on me earlier. When this happened, my tendon snapped, and they had to tie it back on. Yep. Right. I had to think about.
We all left. Two packs.
How can I get back to training as soon as possible? What makes the tendon grow back? All that stuff. So there's blood flow, which is still theory. Some people think that's crucial. Some people think it's not. I think it is.
My orthopedic surgeon said it was. That's why you immediately have, like, when you have a complete detachment, which I had. He says, we immediately, and I got it done 2 days later. He goes, immediately have to get at it because there's no blood flow to the tendon. It will atrophy.
Yeah.
You know?
So there's that, and then there's what is it, what ingredients make it, because we eat meat clean off the bone. We don't eat tendons and ligaments and shit. Mm-hmm. You know, back in the Great Depression, they ate chicken bone soup and shit and got all those high concentrations of MSM, chondroitin, and glucosamine.
Right. Yeah.
We don't do that shit anymore.
Yeah.
So, okay, so how do I take care of that? So, Arthrolyze, another species product, has very high concentrations of those three. A lot of that glucosamine, MSM, chondroitin works. It's just a lot of the products don't have enough of it in there.
Mm-hmm.
So the Arthrolyze does. I took it, and then I would get like some kind of supersistence product because that's shown to increase blood flow to the joints. And I put those two together. And when I went in, let's see, I think I went in a month after the surgery or 5 or 6 weeks after surgery. He looked at it and he said no PTs, like just give it like 4 more weeks, do your normal everyday stuff, but don't put any direct weight on it. He goes, in about another month, you'll be good to go.
Oh, wow.
In fact, they were actually surprised when he was telling me to twist my hands and stuff, like how well I was doing everything. He's like, oh, wow. And he looked at it, he said, it looks a lot better than I thought it was going to look. So it definitely helped everything speed up. Now, did I need all that stuff? No, but doing it made everything happen a lot faster, and now I can get back to training.
What about the peptides?
Oh, yeah, and there was little peptides, too.
Those things are miracles.
Those actually, you know, I did the TU500 and BPC-157. So, and...
love that combination.
I've
done it twice.
for that month, for those 4 weeks. And because after, I want to say January surgery, I went back in February. Okay, yeah, so it was, I had it. Went back in for in 2-3 weeks, so it had been about 7 weeks by this point. And after, so I got off the BPC after that because it took some time off. The TB I ran out of, but when I went in there after, they were surprised how quick. So now I'm taking stuff that's signaling the joints to repair. I'm taking all the nutrients to repair it, and I'm increasing the blood flow to the joints. So all there's a puzzle.
Yeah.
So there's a puzzle to how can I repair this tendon fast, and I put all the pieces in there, and it worked perfectly. So
yeah, your recovery has been remarkable, honestly. Yeah.
So it doesn't even. I mean, I can stretch it.
It actually scared me to watch you training the first time. Like, ooh, that's soon.
Yesterday I did a full back workout, pulled and everything.
Wow.
And I didn't feel anything crazy.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. That's
awesome.
Good.
He still. I mean, I'm not directly curling yet.
Right.
Everything else I can do now, and I'm fine.
We'll do a whole nother podcast on peptides.
Oh, that's a whole.
But I can say that I used those same two peptides when I tore my calf muscle, and the orthopedic surgeon and the nursing staff over there would call me the Wolverine, because he said it was remarkable how fast I was healing, like almost unbelievable. He's like, there's no way you can be healing this fast. This is crazy.
Now, granted, if you're a fat ass eating potato chips on the couch taking this shit, it's not going to heal
course,
up fast.
Of course, right.
I mean, we're eating right. I'm literally ingesting what it takes to rebuild that joint.
Right.
So that's one of the reasons. I'm sure you eat on point, too. That's one of the reasons it healed up so quick.
Yeah. Yeah, we're healthy to begin with, and we're mobile, so that's another thing,
That's a big thing, too. So, like, when I was in school and we're doing rotations and physical therapy clinics, there's this very old school mindset of, like, when you're injured, just you need to rest and, like, lay down and do nothing.
No, that's wrong.
And, like, one of the biggest things that they were really pushing for, like, when I started doing rotations and stuff, too, was, like, well, if that's the problem, then now you're injured and now you're just getting, you're injured and now you're getting weaker. So what's the point?
Right.
They started being a lot more aggressive when it came to, like, post-op, physical therapy. And so I know, like, I mean, he's an a whole other category, but I mean, 3 days after I got my pec surgery, I was in the physical therapy clinic, and then like 1 week later, they're already having me like kind of test like tendon integrity, and then wow. like 3 weeks after that, they're having me like pushing dumbbells around, you know, using the cables.
Well, I'm glad to see medical science have caught up with that, you know.
Yeah. It's funny how medical science and because I was watching some show on Netflix and they were talking about how calorie in, calorie out was only applicable if certain conditions are met. So pretty much it's not just calorie in, calorie out. And I'm like, bodybuilders have been saying that shit for fucking 10 years, man.
More than 10 years. Yeah, yeah, saying that. Yeah, it's just
forever.
That, yeah. that what you were saying, Jody, like, the way I think about it is...
I love this. I had to throw this out because right. I had a debate with somebody that was saying that to me. And they're like, no, my coach said it's all about calories in versus calorie out. But then I hear him telling this guy, don't ever eat white rice. Like, you should be eating brown rice.
Right.
And I'm like, they're both 4 calories per gram per carbohydrate.
Yeah.
It's all about calories in versus calorie out. Do you hear yourself?
Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then he calls me an asshole for you know.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he calls me an asshole for calling him out on it. And I'm just like, no, I'm just saying, like, please explain to me why white rice is so bad and brown rice, you know, right. when it's all about calories in versus calories out. You know,
I love white rice.
Yeah.
I've done many shows on white rice.
No, I wasn't getting on that.
No, but I know what you're saying. What you're saying is like it works. Yeah. It worked fine on me.
I'm sorry, that just brought up.
No, I was raised on white rice.
With the thing with the
sparked
rehab and physical therapy, you think about it, for a muscle to heal up and grow, what do? You got to aggravate the shit out of it. So why is it not the same for everything else? Your joints and tendons and stuff, if they sit there and not get any activity, there's nothing signaling that tendon saying, hey, you need to get stronger because this shit keeps happening to you. There's no stress. Granted, you're not going to go put the 100% of stress on as you would in the gym, but if it's injured, there's a little rest time. Then there comes a point where you got to start aggravating it a little bit so it starts signaling itself to get stronger. Mm-hmm. And you start back way further than you normally would and just do your typical baby steps up. Mm-hmm. That's all it is. It's just... people are so afraid to move shit and stuff when they get injured. It's like, no, they're, you know, if, like, this was, I had that arm brace and this was tight as shit. And I would just, every once in a while, I would just lower another 10 degrees until it finally stretched out all the way.
I was doing the same thing.
Yeah. And then I couldn't, you know, I wouldn't pick nothing up over a 5-pound plate. Mm-hmm. And then I got to where I accidentally grabbed 10. I was like, oh shit, that's fine. So then, you know, you see me, I'd be in there with the bands just fucking around. Even though if I couldn't feel it, I would just move and move, just pump it up.
Yeah.
And then here they are telling me that I'm healing up faster than expected when they were telling me not to use it.
It's crazy. It's awesome.
I mean, you can tell. There's a difference between being, like, injured and just hurting. You know, there's, you know, you can do it and be like, oh, that hurts. Yeah, but you're not injured. You know when there's going to be that point. Mm-hmm. But honestly, with the new generation comes, there's more of a pussified mentality. But, I mean, if you go out there, you can tell when you're hurting a little bit and when you're about to fuck something up.
Yeah.
But you're a bodybuilder. You're also an elite trainer. Like, you are very connected to your body. Where a lot of, like, I'm working with one client who came in to me, and she has a shoulder injury. And it's amazing because her physical therapist is like, oh, don't move it. Don't move it at all. And for more than a year, she's been dealing with this thing, not like...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And like, the mobility of her side lateral movement, you know, on the one side was like this. And she goes, and look, I can get it up this far. And she goes like that.
Oh, my God.
See?
What?
You know? And so I'm like, no, that's your trap lifting. You're getting zero, like, zero mobility work right here, you know? And they're like, well, they said don't do that, you know? So what did we do? We started doing delt, very light delt flies. And now she has full mobility.
That's crazy.
Now, there's still a little pain in there, but we're working on it, you know? But she had no mobility when we started all, you know? And it's just amazing that she has since switched physical therapists.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
And now she's driving all the way out to the North Shore. But this one's like, mobility. Mm-hmm. Yeah, move it.
Well, it's a cover-your-ass tactic, I think, some doctors put on there. And it's a cover-your-ass thing, but at the same time, if you want to progress and get better, you have to take a risk. You have to do something. So that applies. Yeah. Same thing applies to that. It's like if you just sit there and say, don't move it because you're afraid to move it, it's never going to get any better.
Right.
At some point, you have to be like, all right, we got to start chancing this a little bit and get it to where it was at.
And then, like, tying back to some more supplements in the healing part, one of the things I like to incorporate with injuries and stuff is natural anti-inflammatories. Because inflammation, you need a little bit of inflammation to signal, like, the repair peptides, like BP-157, like we were talking about, is actually an endogenous peptide created by the gut. And the signal it gets it's signal production comes from inflammation, right? Okay. So that inflammatory signal say, hey, guess what? We need some repair stuff. So you don't want to blend it 100% completely. Inflammation is necessary for a lot of processes in the body, including hypertrophy. But but too much chronic inflammation, acute inflammation is what we call, you know, the correct inflammation at the necessary times. Chronic inflammation restricts blood flow, you know, and that's going to restrict healing, you know. So
you're not a big fan of, for inflammation, for taking like Motrin or...
No, not ibuprofen, because...
You're not a fan of it?
No, because for one, those are... Ibuprofen is a COX-1, COX-2 inhibitor, right? Those are pro-inflammatory cytokines, right? COX-2 is basically the cytokines that go to the joints, that go to the injury and all that kind of stuff. But COX-1 is necessary for creating and maintaining the mucosal lining of our guts. Mm. So that's why a lot of people, they take a ton of ibuprofen, they end up getting leaky gut syndrome.
Yeah.
Because now all of a sudden your body's not creating, because it happens through that cytokine, you know, where the mucus is actually coating that lining of the gut, which is necessary for digestion processes, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, so, I mean, Celebrex, I believe, is just a COX-2 inhibitor, you know? Mm. I could be wrong. Am I?
Oh,
no. Okay, all right.
Just know you don't want too many cocks.
But anyway, I kind of
like... Yeah, I do know that Celebrex is like recently like associated with all kinds of like heart disease.
Oh, there's a whole thing on it, yeah.
But I like, I mean, I like curcumin, which is the which is the extract of turmeric, you know, it's highly anti-inflammatory. And the big one I like is, there's a product called Amicol, which is basically broccoli seed extract. Mm. Broccoli seeds have the highest amount of a compound called glucoraphanins out of any food on the planet that we know of today, you know? No. And glucoraphanins are the precursor to the most powerful anti-inflammatory cytokine in our bodies called sulforaphane.
Sure.
You know? So you want that high concentration of glucoraphanins to produce our own endogenous sulforaphane to attack that chronic inflammation.
Okay. Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's great.
Now, you can just eat broccoli sprouts because that has a super high concentration of it.
Right.
If you went, but you even have a greater concentration if you ate broccoli seeds, but oh my God, that's like disgustingly bitter. It's like, oh, I tried it. It's like horrible. Like, oh, I'll never do that again. I'll stick with the broccoli sprouts. You know?
Yeah.
But now they make a supplement, which is kind of cool.
Which is fairly new.
Yeah. And I actually have her on both of those, curcumin and then Amicol, which is the broccoli seed extract.
Well, that's pretty good.
Yeah.
You also, don't you? You love to take MCT oils, right?
Yes. I'm a big fan of MCT oil.
Yeah.
Especially if you're pretty fat adaptive, right?
Yeah.
MCT oil is phenomenal for ketosis, too, actually. Let's see. Where do we go with this? All right. So remember we were talking about... short chain triglycerides, medium chain, long chain. Short chain triglycerides is basically a fatty acid with three glycerol molecules attached to it. That's the triglyceride.
Yeah.
You know, short chain fatty acids are anywhere from 2 to 5 carbon atoms with the three glycerol molecules. And then, which is like butyrate, acetate, propionate. You know, those are short chain fatty acids found in like grains and like fermented grains and those kind of things, you know, some trace amounts in vegetables. Medium chain triglycerides are anywhere from 6 carbon atoms to 12 carbon atoms attached to the glycerol, you know.
Okay.
And then that's your lauric acid, your caprylic acid, your carlic acid. And now those... medium chain and short chains, remember we said they don't require L-carnitine to get into the mitochondria.
Right, right.
And then you have your long chain fatty acids, which are anywhere from 13 to 22, 22 being the longest one that we know of. You know what I mean? And so when you get an MCT oil product, the thing is that you're getting that energy super fast because it doesn't require L-carnitine, which is not a very efficient process. That's why L-carnitine works very well when you supplement with it, you know, to really push that fat mobilization.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So when you take in MCT oil, you're getting that instant energy. MCT oil cannot store as body fat. It can't store in adipose tissue,
right.
You know. Neither can short chains, right? They're either oxidized, you know, or they're basically oxidized, you know, or the medium chains actually, and I'll get into that in a little bit, convert to the three endogenous ketones that our bodies produce in the liver, right? So when you get an MCT oil product, the way I like to use it with my clients is like, oh, I'm just like, you know, I am like, you have me on low carbs and I'm just kind of, my energy levels are super low, you know, I just need that boost, like, at this point of like when I'm in class or something like that. And I'll say, oh, I'll take a couple tablespoons of MCT oil.
A couple tablespoons.
Yeah, actually, ooh. Yeah.
Whenever I use that, it goes through me. Again,
This could be why.
Okay.
Because when you look at an MCT oil product, right, you have to be very in tuned or aware of what you're getting, right? Because you'll look on the back, and a lot of people have asked me that, what is this C8, C10, C12? Have you seen that, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
Right, so the C8 C stands for carbon, and then the 8 is the 8 carbon atoms, right? So remember 6 to 8, or 6 to 12 is the MCT oils. Right. So you have 6, C8 is caprylic acid. Caprylic acid is the C8.
Okay.
And then the C10 is the carlitic acid, and then the C12 is the lauric acid, right? If you just have the C6 or the C8 or something like that, it has a like very negative effects on the gut, right? That's where you kind of get that stuff.
Yeah,
so that's why a lot of these new products are adding the C12 and the C10, because it actually kind of buffers the gut, you know, from its action, you know. But the beauty, like, you want a product that's highest in C8. And why? Because even though all three of those will convert to ketones in the liver, the three endogenous ketones are acetylacetate, beta-hydroxybutyrate, and then acetone, you know. And those three, beta-hydroxybutyrate is the one that has the greatest ability to pass the blood-brain barrier. Now, if you want that, everyone talks about that great cognitive feeling that they get from, you know, like being in ketosis.
Right.
That's beta-hydroxybutyrate. You know, just like, it's a nootropic. It's just like, whoa. And you get that from MCT oil, right? Particularly one highest in C8. So look for that when you're buying your MCT oil product, that it's highest in C8. Because that's the one that's going to convert the C10 and the C12 particularly don't convert to beta-hydroxybutyrate. They convert into the other ones.
Okay.
You know, and they do have the ability to work in the, you know, to pass the blood-brain barrier, but not as quite as well as the BHB, beta-hydroxybutyrate. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's why the C8 one is the, and I think Dave Asprey, if you guys know who that is, like the Bulletproof Coffee.
Oh, yeah.
Like, so he has a product that's just pure C8. But you can only take it in small doses because it will mess up your gut. you know what I mean?
You just gotta watch.
But the products that I use, damn, and I'm sorry, I can't remember the brand.
That's all right.
Yeah, but there's a number of them. I know Quest has a good product. They actually have a powdered one and stuff like that. But that's why I like it. So it's like almost like using, it's basically a precursor of an exogenous ketone, you know, which are pretty popular now, like exogenous ketones, which I've never tried, you know, but, you know, our liver is so efficient at producing them, you know, and now here's another thing, coconut oil is about 65% MCT oil. You know, so if you didn't want to, right, yeah.
A lot of the products, that's what they say.
Right, like and most MCT oil is made from coconut oil, just like refined. Yeah. So when you're looking for your MCT, look for the one that's predominant in C8, and that's what that means, you know. That's the it's the one that's going to give you the greatest cognitive enhancement.
I used to diet on it back in the day, like in the 90s when it first was came out.
It was popular.
I would put it on my
but because of the whole keto fad that's out there now, it's become very popular again.
It's come back again, right?
Yeah.
I used to use it. Yeah. And again, I would just put a little bit on my like tuna fish. Or
I use it in my coffee every single morning with lion's mane extract, but that's a whole other topic.
Okay.
Mushrooms and stuff.
Yeah. A lot of information. Yeah. I mean, a lot of information. So.
Well, there's so much to talk about, but, you know, but yeah.
Yeah, basic supplementation. I mean, there's so much.
Did you want to add anything your favorites?
No, I mean, you guys kind of covered everything. You know, I'm definitely a
I think we're all
protein supplement.
We're all like emphasizing the same oil, things. Yeah.
Vitamin C's. I love the vitamin C for cells.
There's a problem with vitamin C that a lot of people don't get because it's water soluble.
Yeah.
Like vitamin C goes in and out of your system right. in 4 hours.
It's quick.
Like so, I kind of like chewable vitamin C's because you can like keep it like active. Like if you're coming into like the flu season and you want to keep your vitamin C levels, people think, oh, I take 1,000 milligrams in the morning. Guess what? That 1,000 milligrams is out.
That's why I tell people you have to take it like 6 times, 7 times.
You do.
A day. Like,
yeah,
that's
absolutely.
What I tell people. You have to take it every when. So when I was eating 6 meals a day, like I would just take a bunch with each meal. You know what I mean?
Yeah, very good.
That's
right.
I mean, people would think, oh, I took 3,000 in the morning, I'm good or whatever. Yeah. It's like, wow, you just pissed half of that.
Yeah. So,
yeah, that's the thing, right?
I would space out for the day, but I actually specifically say not chewable to all my clients.
Just because of sugars.
It's actually really bad for your enamel.
Oh, is it?
For the enamel.
Oh, I didn't know that. Your teeth. Yeah. Oh, wow, okay. Like
because it's so acidic.
Yeah.
Because the vitamin C is very
acidic. You mean especially vitamin C. Don't do chewable.
Vitamin C is like extremely acidic.
Okay, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Okay, hey, forget what I said about that.
I mean, the powdered one, if you can get powdered, that's probably the best. To me, anyway, the powder version. Because then you skip, you know, when you take the pill and you've got all these fillers and things in the pill too, right?
Right, right.
So you just kind of skip all that. You get the powder, mix it in, drink it. It's kind of easy.
Yeah, I usually always get the vitamin C with rose hips just because it helps.
One, it's like assimilate.
If you just get like straight vitamin C and you start trying to take it with water, it starts to like dissolve already while it's in your mouth.
Right.
If you can't get it down like the first try, then it's like really hard to get it down. And eventually you just kind of give up and you're like, well, screw it. And you throw it away.
Yeah.
But I would get it with the rose hips, makes it easier for it to like pass, but it also kind of extends the level, like the amount of time that it takes for it to actually dissolve and break down in the gut.
Right. Yeah. It's the add on. Yeah, so I mean, my big things like proteins, you know, amino acids. Like Jed was saying, I'm not a huge BCAA fan, but more just full spectrum amino acids.
So BCAAs just turn on protein synthesis. Yeah. They're like signaler, like they signal mTOR, which is the mannolinium target of rapamycin. It's basically it's like the light switch that turns on muscle protein synthesis. You know, and then. But the way your body goes through transcription and translation of a DNA molecule, RNA, into a new muscle protein, like there's like this ribose molecule off to the side that actually like takes essential amino acids, you know, and binds them to create that. Like, so your BCAAs, which is, you know, leucine, isoleucine, and L-valine, just those three, they turn on protein synthesis, but they don't complete it. Whereas the essential amino acids, and the reason why we don't talk about non-essential, because your body can produce them on its own.
Right.
You know, if you took in all 9 of the essential amino acids, your body can produce the 11 non-essentials, you know, just from the 9, you know. Mm-hmm. So don't worry about the 11. Take in the full 9, and then you're completely covered for all the building blocks of muscle protein synthesis.
Because I know BCAA is the thing. Is it Jody had even covered this before a while back? Because a lot of people, I mean, it tastes good, especially when you're on a diet and you're like, oh, mix it in your thing during workout, have a little bit after workout, have a little bit before you go to bed. You're thinking, hey, zero calories. This thing tastes sweet. I like it, and it's helping me, right? It's helping me like recover. But and he covered it before. Was like, hey, that's not zero calories.
No, it's not.
You're putting in calories, guys. Like and then people wonder, like, man, I'm just not dropping, or it's like, and then you look and it's like, oh, I'm having like 4 or 5 servings of BCAAs every day. And then people will do in the morning, right? They'll get up, they'll have a bunch of BCAAs, and then do their fasted cardio, which now at this point it's not.
But here's why that's a waste of money. Like, if you're on a contest diet, you're getting enough protein in.
Right.
Like, protein is the one, and we've talked about this when we were talking about dieting. You're getting more than enough protein in where now, there is a thing to be said about intra-workout, because that's actually where about the only time, unless you're doing stupid amounts of cardio, where you're risking actually muscle protein breakdown. And then, you know, the EAAs at that point can like be protective, you know. But the drink them in between meals and stuff, like, waste of money.
Yeah.
Waste of money. And, you know, just go out and get Crystal Light. It'll be so much cheaper and you'll have your flavored water. You know?
I know. Yeah. I think that's what a lot of people do.
One of the other like important things that gets looked over too on that is Dave Palumbo's talked about it a lot too, but it's just like kind of throwing off your amino acid profiles.
That's very true.
By only downing like, you know, a bunch of L-valine and isoleucine and leucine, and you're just drinking that all day long. It's like those levels are very high, which then, you know, he's seen people start to develop like issues with their eyesight, issues with digestion, which I think is a huge thing nowadays with bodybuilding, because I mean, it happened to myself as well as like pretty much every pro I knew, and then it started happening to clients, and it started happening to like to you, to a bunch of us. It's like no matter what protein drink we shake, like the protein shake that we would drink, you know, all of a sudden we're just like, God, every single one of them hurts my stomach.
Yeah.
Or we're all on the fucking toilet.
It got to that point, yeah.
And that was like, I think it has to do a lot with that, and then just kind of continuously adding into stuff, but then this is a whole other topic, but then I think that, like, I think because protein shakes taste so much better nowadays, that there's got to be something with, like, the flavoring systems that they use that, like, irritates the gut, too.
Yeah.
Probably.
And going on the calorie things, like, you got to be careful, like, sugar alcohols and stuff that are flavoring these things. You think they're calorie-free. They're not.
Yeah.
You know, okay, so they don't get absorbed in the small intestine, but they get absorbed in the colon because they go through a fermentation process, and then glucose molecules are extracted. And that's why FDA labels show fiber, you know, because fiber, soluble fiber does this, you know. Everyone think, oh, soluble fiber, it's free. Like, no, it's not.
Right.
There's a reason why it's part of the calorie content of, and it's labeled under the carbohydrates, is because studies showed that depending on your epigenetics, you can extract anywhere from like 1 to 3 calories per 1 gram of fiber, you know, out of that fiber through that fermentation process in the colon. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So on average, most people were getting about half the calories, you know? So like if you counted in your carbohydrate mix, if you got like, and there's a lot, like a lot of these keto friendly processed foods are full of fiber. Full of this soluble fiber, you know, these prebiotic fibers, which are resistant starch fibers. All that stuff, like, when it makes it down to the colon, you could be getting, the way I like to look at it for my clients is that, look at that as about half, like, if you have, let's just say 10 grams of this fiber, right, would be 40 calories if it was a carbohydrate, you know? So I say, count half of that, like, you're getting 20 calories out of that, you know, basically. Because potentially you could be.
Right.
You know, so to think that you're getting this shit calorie free, like those people that chronically chew gum during prep, you know, over and over, you know, that shit can add up. Yeah, exactly, because that's full of a lot of sugar alcohols. And then these people that are drinking the BCAAs that have those artificial sweeteners in them, you know, and that stuff, or, you know, and they're doing...
Right.
And I wanted to go over this, but Shawnee knows this, you know, and we take it into account. But when she was looking at all that stuff, there was a lot of that kind of soluble fiber, or, you know, that was in those foods, like saying, hey, look, it's low, it's this and that. But, you know, yeah, you got to kind of even it's on the label for a reason, you know, as, you know, being counted as a carbohydrate.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Well, we're losing Jed here, so Jed's, you know, he's taking his GHB. Ooh, GHB, remember that one?
Oh,
bring it back to old school.
I never got to use that one.
GHB,
GABA.
I want to try.
Anyway, we won't talk about that right now. We'll leave you guys cliffhanger GHB. Okay, look it up. But anyway,
that was a good one, guys. A lots of information today, and. You know, we'll probably just put a couple things down in the link. Some of the supplements that we had talked about, we'll put a couple things down in there so you guys can check it out.
And the also, brands of MCT oil that I like.
some of the brands of MCT oils and other things. And also, remember, hit subscribe. Hit that bell button for all the updates.
Join the IHF Insider group on Facebook and be one of the cool people.
Yeah. IHF Insider, Facebook, don't forget. And Iron Hawaiian Fitness. On Instagram. Yeah. All right, guys. Aloha and see you next time.